All right. Great to have you here with us. Thanks for coming in this morning. You know, we were singing that song, and I have to admit to you that I didn't grow up in church and didn't know all of the Christian Christmas songs and didn't sing them till I was in my 20s. I mean, I knew Burl Ives kind of songs, Holly, Jolly Christmas, and I knew if you sang about snowmen, I knew those songs. But I didn't know, and I can still remember in my 20s, somebody helping me with that song saying, if you just think eggshells, you can say the word right, because I didn't know. I mean, Latin's not one of my strong suits, and so I was, how do you say this, sing this thing? So if you're here and you're new, this is the place for you. So you just sing eggshells, and you'll be okay. Okay? Hey, we're also thrilled for those of you over in the theater. Thanks for coming. I got to worship over there last weekend, and enjoyed that service over there, and Josh and his leadership over there. And we've been working our way through a thing called the story. And as we work towards Christmas early on, we thought there's a tremendous theme that shows up in the story that really does lend ourselves towards Christmas. That one of the names that we give the Christ child is Emmanuel, God with us. And the amazing implications that God would not be among us, not be over us, not be aware of us, but actually make the effort to be with us, to be identified as one of us. And I started to go back and just do a little looking, and on your handout you can begin to see how this with theme just has been traced throughout all of the story that we've done. We saw that God was with Adam and Eve in the garden. He came and talked with Cain. And said, look, relax here. If you keep going down this road, it's not going to turn out well. And of course, it didn't. He was with Noah. And these are verses that specifically said God was with them. Abraham, of course, many times it's said that he was with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. Each of those in their weird, quirky, different journeys, God is with them. Moses, it is said that God is with him. And then when Joshua took over for Moses, God came to him and said, as I was with Moses, I will be with you. This come over and over again. We saw it with the judges. We see it in Samuel. We see it in David. In fact, over 50 times it says that God was with David. And then Solomon, his son, and then moving into the prophets and some of the story that we'll do between now and the first of the year and Easter, where we'll work our way through the rest of the story, we'll see that God is with the prophets, he is with Solomon, he's with some other kings, and there's several kings he's not with. And then, of course, he was with Christ. And this idea that God is actually with us. But as soon as I say that, I mean, isn't it true that with the things that happened in Newtown, Connecticut just 2 days ago, that those kinds of thoughts are thrown in a little bit of doubt? Isn't it fair to say, or at least ask, if he's with us, where was he Friday? Did he skip the state? Was he over in Washington because he needed so much of his attention there? What's up with that? If God is with us, why does stuff like this happen? So Saturday morning when I woke up, I knew my sermon was all changed. The handout will be of some value, but not much. As we begin to try to ask, what's up with this? If God is really with us, what's the Christian perspective towards this? Now, I have to tell you that I basically went back in my journal over the last two journals that I've had, working through the last 8-plus months, and took things out that have spoken to me and have helped me, and I thought I'd share them with you. I have no airtight answers. We won't solve this morning, but we'll honestly take a look at it. And see, I believe, that even though there are no answers that fully address all of the objections and all of the questions, that why is still ringing in our ears as we read the stories again this morning in the newspapers and saw the pictures of the victims now, Every child only 6 or 7 years old. I think the more we learn, the more tragic it will be. So I can't solve this for us. But I think we can turn to the scriptures and, more importantly, turn to Christ, who decided to be identified with this mess in a very special way. So let me pray for us. I'll need it. And let's take a look at it. Father, we are grateful that you are, in fact, with us. We need not invite you here. That your presence is among us. Truth is, God, that there's about 50 different expectations about what that means in the room. And if we had the chance to all express them to you, it'd be quite an array of things we think that are your job. Could we learn, please, from you a little bit today? Could we understand more of what it means for you to be with us? Would you help us to find the kind of peace and proper balance in how we lay out this whole issue of evil in our world? We thank you in advance that you did not view things from afar, that you did not spin the world into motion and then just sit back and watch, but that you took on flesh and identified with our suffering to the point of death. To pay for sin, surely, but also to show how much you love us. May that ring true for us. And may this time bring you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. The wrestling with pain and trying to reconcile the evil and pain that we experience in the world versus the character of God that we're taught in the scriptures of goodness, kindness, and love is a difficult proposition. If you have thought very deeply about this for any length of time, it is difficult to understand how a God of love and compassion could allow such messes to go on. This juxtaposition of evil and God's character is called theodicy. It's a theological term that talks about the tension. And that's exactly what it is. The scriptures, when we go to them, don't seem to want to solve the tension. There are some who try to push the tension enough to make sense of it. One camp you might call Augustinian. They would be the kind of people who would blame everything on sin. It's sin's fault or Satan's fault. They try to make sure that God is not held responsible for all that goes on. They tend to minimize some of God's role in things and play out for us the choices that we make amplified on generation upon generation, and then what we have left is the society that we live in today. There's certainly a lot of truth in that view. Another view would be what we would call the Arminian view, and this view would be the kind of understanding that says, yeah, bad stuff happens, but there is divine purpose behind it all. And that God actually orchestrates and allows these bad things to happen in such a way so that His good can be accomplished. If Augustinian seems to emphasize the past a lot, the Arminian view seems to emphasize the future a lot. That the hope is that this is all going to eventually turn out in the end. And everything will be fine. And there is certainly some truth in that view. There's another view, and it's pretty recent, actually, or it's the name I'm going to give it to is identified with a guy. There was a book written 25 years ago or so, Why Do Bad Things Happen to Good People, by a guy named Rabbi Kushner. We'll call this view the Kushnerian view. It would say that there is a God of love, of great love for every one of us, and He knows us. But the truth is that the societies that we exist in are beyond His control. And so to blame God for any of it is really misappropriated because he's not responsible. He cannot do anything about what's going on. It's too big a deal. Now, he loves us deeply. But he can't really do much about what's going on. Something's set in motion and it's going to play itself out. And there are some truths in that view. The truth is, we don't know why. That is the truth of it. Why things happen seems to be a question that the scriptures very rarely even acknowledge, much less address. I'll show you an example of that in Luke chapter 13. Some people were talking to Jesus about why some stuff was happening to some bad people. And apparently some things had happened in Jesus' day where some people were singled out and killed unfairly. Chapter 13, verse 1, it says, "There were some present at the time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with the sacrifices. And Jesus answered, 'Do you think that those Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way?'" Do you really believe that it's a direct cause and effect about what's going on, and if you're good, you live life out really well and everything goes okay for you, and if you're bad, then you suffer? Do you really believe? He's saying, do you really believe in that sophomoric kind of view towards God that boxes him into such a small space? If you're paying attention and if I'm paying attention, we clearly know that the rats are winning the rat race. That the good seem to suffer. The innocent in Connecticut seem to die. And Jesus says, if you look at things like that, he says, I tell you no, but unless you repent, you too will perish. Or those 18, he goes on to say, he mentions another current event. If he were speaking today, he would definitely use Newtown, Connecticut. Or those 18 who died when the tower in Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than the others living in Jerusalem? You think that the why is that? I mean, how easy it would be, how simplistic it would be for us to say, well, somebody did something wrong and so they were punished. He says, I tell you no. But you too will perish if you don't repent. But there's this issue is one of understanding that to try to box things in such a way where you can make complete sense of all that goes on, as soon as you think you've got it figured out, you're in dangerous water. Because the mind of God and the way that these things are playing out are beyond us. So what can we know? Well, we can know this for sure, that God was at the school in Connecticut, weeping, brokenhearted at the effects of a family's tragedy played out in a town's grief. That it was not his desire that this happen. Can he turn good from it? I am certain that he can, but he didn't have it happen so he could. The effects of our own choices and the amplified effects of sin in our lives sometimes causes very hurt people to hurt people. And he has chosen to veil his direct authority over the interactions of mankind and allowed us the freedom to choose, because it is in that environment alone that a context of love can exist. But he did more than that. He completely identified and entered into the pain. Perhaps the most famous Christmas narrative that's never given credit to be a Christmas narrative is in Philippians chapter 2 that speaks of God's visit to us. And let me remind you that our Christmas story has as a part of it a mass murder of young children. Does God understand the pain of what is going on in Newtown? Absolutely. And his heart is broken for it. Philippians chapter 2 is called the Carmen Christi, the Song of Christ. As you look at this little paragraph inside chapter 2, most Bible scholars believe that it became one of the first hymns of the church. That when they had the different instruments and all of the things that were going on, that this became a song, first sung in Greek and then in Latin, and then finally into English, for generation upon generation, beginning in the very first century of the church. Maybe if we go back when they started singing it in English, it would have sounded something like this. Back when we knew how to sing parts. Who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. The wording of this hymn begins with a very intentional use of words so that we can understand that he was the very essence of God, preexistent from eternity past. He did not become God. He did not evolve into God. There was never a time ever, as far back as you can go, that Jesus was not God. He didn't earn God's status. He didn't live well and somehow evolve into that. He has been and has always been God eternal. In that lofted form and existence of God, he did not consider that elevated position something to hang on to, something that he could have had the right to say, choose someone else, Father. I don't think I want to hang on a cross. I've never known hunger. I've never known being tired. I've never known needing sleep. I've never felt pain. I've never cried actual tears because of the hurt inflicted on me. But he willingly, it says, made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, literally slave. He didn't come as Lord this time. He didn't come as king. He will come next time as both Lord and King, but this time he did not. He came as slave, doulos, the very lowest of his society. In fact, when they came out with the birth announcements and they mailed them all out, God chose to mail the birth announcements to let everybody know his son had been born to the very lowest economic rungs of society. He was being made in human likeness, like us completely, with one exception. He was born without sin nature. He was incarnate, which is a weird word. It's a word that we only use around Christmas time, and even then, very few times. Incarnate means to take on the existence in human form, but it means more than that. It also means to be made manifest or comprehensible. By him taking on flesh, he showed the great extent that God would say, it's not enough for them to kind of know of me, but I want them to know me. It's not enough for them to hear of me. I want them to see me. It's not enough for them to be related to me. I want them to be my sons and my daughters. God intervened in time, space, history by taking on flesh and identifying with all of the crap that came with it. All of the pain, all of the suffering he subjected himself to, and more, we'll see. Because he was humiliated. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. Became obedient to death, even death on a cross. It's enough to say that God would come and die for you, but he chose specifically a time where he could be identified with the worst type of execution mankind has ever devised. Nothing more humiliating, nothing more painful, the slow, agonizing death that Christ chose for us. You see, when we think about the things that are going on and the things that we're wrestling with and the why questions that come to us, we don't get the answers sometimes to those questions, but we do get the example of a God who would join in on it. Not that would sit somehow separated from all of the pain, but that actually would join into the mess and be humiliated to the point of death on a cross. It was at that point that I believe Satan and all of his cohorts and the forces of evil threw the largest parties in the world. And then God exalted the Son and he defeated death and the die was cast. Therefore God, verse 9, exalted him to the highest place. Gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. He is exalted and he is triumphant, and there is a time. It is not beyond his control. Things have not grown too large. We didn't get a little too busy down here and outgrow God's influence. There's a time when his plans will come. Evil continues to exist because we're told in 2 Peter that God's slowness to return is because of his desire that none should perish. I thank God he didn't come in 1973. And he waited at least till 1974. And there are some around the planet, even now, that he's waiting for. Why is he tarrying? He's waiting for some. Perhaps you today will finally turn and say, God, you don't answer all my questions, but you at least identified and loved me in such a way that I can understand. I surrender to Christ as my Savior. At some point, when the math is right, and that's the only thing I can think of, there's going to be a time when God looks at it all and says, okay, the most amount have come. At some point, he's going to close the door. And he will put an end to the madness we inflict on ourselves and the pain that we cause. Until then, he chooses to veil himself. It's like this. This is an illustration that helps me understand why God doesn't intervene in more powerful ways. It's like if you were the richest man on the planet and you were single. Ah, let's change it. You're the richest woman on the planet and you're single, okay? And in order for you, you're afraid that no matter what you do, no matter how many men court you, that they're just after your money. The only way that you could be absolutely certain that they're dating you for you and they're actually falling in love with you, independent of your wealth, is that you would hide your wealth and live as if someone who is poor, or at least normal. And then once you were assured of their great love for you, that they had actually fallen in love with you as a person, not you as the baroness, then you could reveal who you really were. Right? I mean, you'd never know really for sure.
And I would just tell you this, God cannot reveal himself in full glory. He cannot intervene in such a way that he would like to do possibly, where his children never have anything happen to them that are bad. Because then the free choice, he would not know. Are people coming to me so their lives would work, or are they coming to me because they love me? And so God has chosen to veil his glory and offer Christ. C.S. Lewis says it this way, God cannot ravage, he can only woo. And he is in the process, in the midst of this painful, joyous, mixed up world we live in, of wooing people to himself through the offer, his best offer, of Jesus Christ. In the midst of that, Christ's life and death secures salvation for everyone who would embrace it. And that just as the sufferings of Christ flow into our lives, and we can identify that Christ understands our sufferings, so also the joy and the hope of Christ overflow into our lives. The Father, God himself, is with us. I've been gearing up for this series for several weeks and trying to contemplate about just the reality of God being with us. That we don't need to invite him in. He's already there. We simply need to acknowledge him. So when Mark and I began dreaming this up, we said the Advent challenge for us as a community, one of the things that we want to call you to and help walk together in this, is to begin to acknowledge on a moment-by-moment basis that God is with us. In our doubts, in our objections to him, in our questions that go unanswered, in our rejoicing in our most beautiful times and in our most confused times, God is there, fully present. So I thought, I need a help with that. I can't just, be told that. And so, ushers, come on down. We made little stickers. And if you need a sticker to help you, we made one that just has a sticker on it and it just says with. You can stick this somewhere. I stuck it on the back of my phone. I hate to admit this, but I just can't go anywhere without this phone. I don't know how I live without a smartphone. It's amazing to me how much my life has changed because of this. And so I take my phone everywhere, so I put it right there. You might put it on the mirror of your car, your rearview mirror. You might put it on your iPad. You might put it on the monitor screen of your computer. You might put it on the mirror in your bathroom. You might stick it on the back of your left hand, but it won't stay there long. Nobody has to take one if you don't want one. God won't be with you more if you have a sticker. But it's a way for us to begin to acknowledge this Advent challenge that God has done all he can without violating our free will. He has done all he can to let us know how much he loves us. Now, there are implications from that, and we'll talk about this next week. I'll come back and I'll say, because God is with us and because of what Christ has done, we can be with God. And there's some all kinds of things that we can look at with that. But this week, I want to just challenge you to begin to acknowledge this. Now, one of the ways that this is practiced, there's a guy named Brother Lawrence who wrote a book, Practicing the Presence of God, and it's a classic, Christian classic. And in fact, he was just a dishwasher. And he just began to invite God and acknowledge that God's presence was there even while he was washing these dirty dishes. And then he wrote down all of the things that he learned about acknowledging God is there. It is a constant struggle. But here's one of the things that I've been kind of doing for me is practicing a little bit what some might call a breath prayer. Mine right now is, I've got two. Mine, the way out is through for me. For the hard things that I'm wrestling with, especially in this Christmas season, the way out is through. I got to go through a Christmas. I got to get one under my belt without Clay. I just have to. There's no way around. I mean, I can't skip it. I guess I could in protest, but that wouldn't honor Clay or my God. The way out is through. So I've been saying that and just acknowledging, God, you're with me. You've promised to be with me through this. Because there's a theology of hard times. Let me just remind you of it. You probably, hopefully some of you remember it. There's a theology that the Bible teaches about of suffering and having hard times. And it's not if, but when. You're promised that there's going to be hard times happen. If you thought by coming to Jesus that everything would work out perfect and you thought that was promised, we got to visit. Because in fact, what's promised is that you'll have hard times. And if Christianity is supposed to make your life work perfectly, then it didn't work for the dude who founded it. His life had a couple of bad things happening, like dying a criminal, shoved in a borrowed cave, dying alone. So it's not if, but when. And it's not around, but through. Very rarely does God just reach down and pick you up and say, that's too hard. Let me put you over here. What he usually does is comes along beside you and says, I will be with you. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you with my righteous right arm. We will go through this together. Not if, but when. Not around, but through. And then not evil, but good. God's plans for you are not evil. They are to prosper you and give you success. There are blessings that go with this. But there are hard things that go along with it as well. God is with us. One final thing. I love the story. There's a Cherokee legend that says that when young boys started entering into manhood, that one of the initiation things that they had to do was they had to go out and spend a night alone in the woods. Their fathers would take these 9, 10, 11-year-old boys out into the woods, blindfold them, sit them next to a tree, and say, do not move. Do not cry out. Do not remove this blindfold until the warmth of the sun rising in the east hits your face. You can only imagine all of the fear of that night. If you spend any time in the woods at night, every little movement sounds like it's a giant bear coming to rip your throat out. At least that's the way guys think about it. And the fear that you have with every little thing that happens. How difficult it would have been for him to trust that he's not going to remove this. He's not going to cry out. He's not going to move. He's going to wait till the heat of the sun reflects to his face. And then the story says, the legend says, that finally that warmth would hit on the small boy's face, and he would immediately just rip that blindfold off, and he would be sure that as he did that, he would see wild dogs or something all around him, and he would look to see that his father was there 5 yards away and had never left. Always there to protect. The chance of the reality of the danger was there, but because of God's presence, there was always resources you knew not of. God is with you. Please don't fall into the sophomoric kind of line of reasoning that goes, since I can't see him or feel him, he must not be here. And for sure don't fall into the thought that, well, my life's not going well, so God can't be here. Now, it may be that God's there and he's very disappointed. It may be that he's there and he's exhorting you to change, to move towards him and away from your selfishness. I can't speak to that. In a crowd this big, I'm sure that's some of that. Some of it's just the encouragement of saying you are not alone. You are not alone in this. God is with us, literally, tangibly with us. Let's pray. God, in this life, so much does not make sense. We want to make sense of it. We want to remove the mystery. We want to We want to figure it out. We want to control it. And you will have none of that. You will not be hemmed in or boxed or limited. You will work because you are God and we are not. So I ask that in a very significant way among us this week, you would allow us the sense of your presence with us. That we would slow enough in the rush, we would slow enough to acknowledge your presence. Some will be a brand new experience for them. I pray they would be filled with joy. Some would be full of doubt. In fact, this would be a great challenge, and I pray that they would dare you to show up. And then, God, you would show up huge. There are some in the room who are certain that they are alone, certain that their circumstances will at least kill their life and ruin their life. And there are some who have gone a long time without acknowledging your presence in their life. Move strongly, God, so that they will have a sense of you. And then, God, the families in Connecticut, the loss would be impossible for most of us to identify with. We ask that you would show yourself strong, that you would give little glimpses of the hope and the love that you have, that you would give words of affirmation of the security of where those children are in your arms and in your love, and that parents will, if they are in Christ, will see them again. And may it be a reminder for us as we move into the holiday season of the richness of the relationships we enjoy. May the sorrow of all the things that go around us not rob us of the joy of the life that you have given us. May we be characterized by that. May it be part of who we are. In Jesus' name, amen.